Anyway, my name is Julian Gutmanis, as Britta said. I work for a cybersecurity firm, Dragos. Excuse me. sorry. So Dragos is a US-based firm. We deal primarily with industrial control system security. So most of the time you'll see our guys running around the plants wearing high-vis protective gear rather than sitting in office environments. I was initially requested to talk today about some incidents that we've been responding to recently, especially the Trisys incident that occurred in Saudi Arabia, which is a petrochemical facility. So I was actually involved in the initial triage team that responded to that incident. However, Dragos has been doing some really awesome research recently, and I thought it would be crazy not to talk about that today. Specifically, the threat intel team has been doing some research on the intent of attackers in some of the major incidents that have occurred in the past. And I find it fascinating information, so hopefully there's some people in the crowd today that are interested in it as well. So basically the concept of a cyber attack actually causing kinetic response and damage to a physical infrastructure is not exactly new. Back in 2007, researchers from Idaho National Labs conducted research into a generator test that they're actually calling Aurora, even further up, okay. So it's called the Idaho National Labs Aurora Generator Test. So basically what happened here was it was a test to determine whether or not a cyber attack could actually cause physical damage to grid infrastructure. So what the researchers did in this scenario is they connected a diesel generator to a transmission substation. Basically what they did was they connected the generator with the grid infrastructure out of phase and frequency of the actual grid. Basically what this is kind of analogous to is revving your car in neutral and then slamming it into drive and then putting it back into neutral and continuing to do that until something happens. So in this test, it took a total of 3 minutes for the researchers to actually start causing damage to the generator. So the generator started to shake when they put it into this scenario. And eventually some parts started flying off it, and about 25 meters away, things were flying around. And eventually it lit fire and started burning. So this scenario is pretty well known. The Aurora test and the Aurora scenario is well known in the grid. It copped a little bit of criticism from specific protection engineers based on the some of the researchers had disabled a couple of the security features of the generator to enable this kind of scenario to occur. The reason I'm giving you background of this stuff is it kind of helps out understanding what these attackers are doing at the moment in recent scenarios. So basically for this test environment, what the researchers did was they acquired a 2.25 megawatt diesel generator. They then connected to the grid through a breaker, which also had a connection through an intelligent electronic device that allowed them to disable and enable the breaker. What they then created was a number of scripts to identify when the generator was out of frequency with the grid, and then to open to connect the breaker to connect it to that grid infrastructure, and then basically just cycling it on and off until they caused damage. So, as a mitigation to this scenario, after it was identified, there are a number of different security and safety mechanisms that are already built into these systems, but also ones that were generated after this scenario. One of these is called a synchronism check relay. So basically what this does is it takes reduced downstepped readings from the generator and also the transmission side to verify that the frequency and the phase is connected, so that they're basically matching before they allow the breaker to connect to the grid. When obviously when they're out of sync, then the breaker won't connect. It also, if it's an operational connection, so the generator is already connected to the grid and it detects a fault, it'll trip and then disconnect. So a synchronism check relay is just one of many protection relays. Basically, a protection relay senses the grid infrastructure, looking at different factors such as current, voltage, insulation, temperature, things like that. Then takes rapid action and analysis of these factors, and then provides specific actions such as visual alarms or removing power to breakers, things like that, disconnecting, opening. As I was saying, so there's a number of different systems within power systems. So the overcurrent relays, distance impedance relays, directional and synchronism check relays. So this up until this point is really just more talking about the grid infrastructure and transmission distribution. They are protections in the generation side. However, in other industrial operations, we see less of the protection systems and more in the safety instrumented systems, such as emergency shutdown systems, depressurization systems, fire and gas suppression, things like that. So this is more looking at oil and gas scenarios, manufacturing to prevent hazardous operations, human life, damage to equipment, things like that. You also see a little bit of an overlap in this. So you'll see industrial operations, so the safety instrumented systems within power generation specifically. So in like nuclear plants or turbines and things like that, you have these safe shutdown mechanisms. So a little bit more onto the overview of the safety system layer. In general, with the protection layer, you're looking at sensing the actual grid to prevent hazardous operations going downstream into the transmission lines, things like that. In the safety layer, what we're doing is we have generally a process control layer, which is doing the day-to-day operation of a infrastructure, so which are plant operations, things like that. There's a secondary layer built into that such that if you start getting into an unsafe condition, the process control layer can shut the plant down or slowly bring it back into a normal state. Should this not occur correctly, the emergency shutdown system then kicks in, so the safety layer kicks in to prevent unsafe conditions occurring. It is pretty close to the last layer of defense. It is not the last layer of defense. After the safety systems, you're looking at more physical controls to contain and mitigate damage to the environment. So you're looking at pressure safety valves, so if there's some kind of pressure built up in like a turbine or something like that. Basically, they're rated to a certain specific pressure, and if it reaches that, it'll just burst, and then you get a release of the pressure to safety. You also have dikes that are basically containing any release of oils and things like that. And then obviously, you have your response layers. I have this photo up here. This is actually a safety system, a photo that I took in Saudi Arabia of the Triconics controller that was, this is a lab photo, but this is the safety system that was attacked by Trisys. So to date, while we have had quite a lot of incidents that have resulted in kinetic impacts to the grid or system outages and downtime, such as, for example, Norsk Hydro that occurred earlier in the year. That was a ransomware incident. Still resulted in impacts to the grid, but it wasn't really focused on impacting the grid. We've really only seen 5 families of malware that are actually ICS aware. So Stuxnet, which is probably everybody's very well aware of. Havix, which is quite a wide approached attack that was targeting the US, the Europe, Middle East, everywhere. Black Energy and Crash Override. Black Energy was a malware family that was also found in a lot of areas, but it also impacted the Ukraine grid in 2015. Crash Override was also subsequently in the grid in Ukraine in 2016. And then Trisys was the incident I was mentioning earlier about the petrochemical facility in Saudi Arabia. So of these 5 malware families, if we take a deeper dive into them, you'll find that actually Havix and Black Energy are only really aware of ICS in the fact of reconnaissance. So they're looking more about enumerating the ICS operations, taking screenshots, things like that, for later use in further attacks. Stuxnet, Crash Override, and Trisys are really the only ones that we have that had an intention to manipulate grid ICS operations. Stuxnet was in the Iranian nuclear enrichment program, very well briefed. Everybody is probably pretty aware of what happened with it. There's great books and movies about it, so I'm not going to go into too much detail on that. The research that's been done by Dragos recently is more into the intentions around Crash Override, which, I find fascinating, so I'm going to go into that in a little bit more detail. And then subsequently, I'll talk a little bit more about Trisys, about what the actual true intentions of the attackers were. Currently, Dragos tracks Crash Override through the Dragos intelligence team as a group called Electrum, and Trisys is known as a Xenotime. Dragos doesn't normally do public attribution to the source of these attackers, but there's other public companies that have attributed these to Russian interests. So going into Crash Override, was an incident or a malware family that resulted in an incident in Ukraine in 2016. So I think it was December 17th, 2016, about the middle of winter. I believe the day before it got to like -10 in Ukraine. So Taking out the power systems within Ukraine at that time was substantial. At the time, analysis into this really focused on the ability to take out the power to the country. The success of this attack was quite poor, actually. So there was about less than 1% of the Ukrainian population that was impacted, and it was approximately just slightly over an hour that the power was out. The malware family that was found, Crash Override, was actually quite sophisticated. It had a lot of functionality that was not seen before. So the thoughts around why this tool was used to cause such a small outage came up. This is really the research that Joe's been doing at the moment, so it's pretty cool. So basically, the overview of how the event flow happened with Crash Override, the attackers had penetrated into the ICS over a long campaign. They'd been in there for quite some time. I believe the initial access to the ICS environment was via a compromised data historian, so the data process historian. From there, they pivoted into the plant via a number of insecurely configured SQL databases using like XP command shell injection code. From there, they used the malware family had a number of modules to open breakers, which is basically disconnecting the power to the grid. It was targeting a specific transmission site within Ukraine. After this, they scheduled another module that was actually a wiper. So after they disconnected all the power, the next module wiped all of the operator systems, so all the HMIs, all of the engineering machines. So they basically had no way of restoring power via the automated process. And then finally, what's interesting is they targeted the protective relays, as I was talking about before, with a previously unseen denial of service attack. So they'd attempted to hit the relays with this DOS attack. This hasn't really been discussed in too much detail in the past, so this is quite interesting. So the functionality of the malware, again, as I was mentioning, the launcher modules, they had a number of modules that are built with this open source and quite publicly adopted industrial protocols. IEC 61850 is very, very widely used around the world and in Australia. The wiper and destruction module, and also one thing that was actually quite interesting is the interactions with the controller layer was actually hard-coded within the malware. So the IP addresses and things were actually hard-coded into it. So it shows that there's a high level of interaction with the attackers in the environment. So the impact was, as I mentioned, pretty limited. There was a number of switches that were open, breakers opened, to basically release power. The engineers managed to get the plant or the power restored within a couple of hours through manual means. So rather than operating through the automated to the human-machine interfaces, they went in and started controlling the breakers manually, switching breakers back on at the transmission grid. So it was a limited impact. Now, some of the interesting things that from the analysis side of things, the malware really, really failed in its main objective. It had targeted hundreds of RTUs for state manipulation, so to release the power from the breakers. It only actually impacted a couple. So it had a minor impact rather than the widespread impact that they'd intended. So most of these RTUs didn't respond, or it seems like the communications failed. It could have been a networking thing or just nuances within the organization, the environment. So again, a much smaller impact than intended. Another interesting mistake that was made, so the actual protection relay attempt, so the denial of service attempt that they made on the protection relays actually completely failed. So the attackers had actually hard-coded the IP addresses of the protection relays, however, messed up an endianness configuration within the IP addresses. So basically what ended up happening was the communications went to invalid IP addresses rather than to the correct relay addresses. If this was successful, the protection relay on the right, so the SIM and SIPROTEC, would go into this firmware update mode that looks like that, basically. So in a scenario where you're under attack and you've been pressured to get the power back on, it looks like a perfectly functioning relay, potentially. Now, in that mode, it's sitting there waiting for firmware update packages and not doing any protection on the grid. So implications of having this function within the denial of service on the relays, firstly, you're creating a hazardous situation for personnel and equipment. If you were to connect or reconnect power back up onto that line without protection, there's a good chance that you may experience an overcurrent situation where transmission power restoring to the grid goes down and starts damaging transmission transformers, things like that. You could also use the attacks to remove the substation from transmission bus. So you could use this relay, the protection relays, to basically just cause a denial of service and a power outage condition, which they already had. Or possibly, as a final consideration, it's possible that you could actually create an aurora-like impact on reconnection of these power lines. So by reconnecting the transmission lines without any visibility of any of the operator stations, straight from the manual connection of the breakers, you could experience some kind of function where, again, like the torque in the environment and cause damage to the underlying transmission infrastructure. Now, some of the interesting approaches for layering this as an attack and basically what you can consider that the attackers have done. Firstly, they created a large-scale they're intended to make a large-scale transmission outage. So this is through the triggering of the breakers. One of the interesting things is the 2015 event, they've almost learned from the 2015 outage by looking at the outage that occurred at a number of substations. It was, again, recovered quite quickly. The energy utility managed to reconnect the breakers quite quickly, but it was a manual focus. So they'd already seen that this is the likely response that's going to be taken by the energy provider. Again, the wiper module removed all visibility and control from the operation consoles. Following on with the protection relay, denial of service attacks, removes protection from the grid. So these three scenarios and the rush to restore power to the organization really gives you this kind of like the perfect storm, right? So you've got a team that are rushing and being yelled at by the management to get power back on. The grid has no protection at all. They just start triggering breakers. The intention could have been much, much worse, or the actual outage could have been much, much worse. Rather than hours, it could have been weeks to months. Another consideration is the availability of transmission infrastructure. Transmission transformers are just not available. If you have a transformer that breaks, recovery time and replacement time could be months to years almost. That's crash override. I'll go into a little bit more detail about Trisys in a similar kind of scenario. So Trisys was, as I mentioned, a petrochemical incident that occurred in August 2017. So when we were actually dispatched to this this incident, it wasn't associated with any malware at the time. It was just a strangely behaving emergency shutdown controller. After we analyzed it, we did find the Trisys malware and escalated it through to the cleanup phases. So a flow of events that occurred in this environment. Again, this is one of the last phases of a quite detailed and long campaign. There was evidence that the attacker had been in there since about 2014. So they've been in the environment for almost 3 years, just working through enumerating what the environment looked like, and then working their way into the plant. I'm not going to go too deep into the malware itself, but basically the objective of the malware was to load a remote access Trojan into the controller memory. So you're talking about a very proprietary system that nobody's really dealt with. The attackers had the ability to inject code into memory and then basically rewrite functionality within the controllers. After they'd done that, they had another module that actually interacted with the injected Trojan, where you could read or write memory. So you potentially could overwrite the safety logic or overwrite the I/O outputs to prevent shutting down the infrastructure in an attack. Fortunately, the last phase of this attack wasn't realized. We caught them before they were able to do anything beyond shutting down the infrastructure. We were able to recover the final stage code that they were trying to inject into the controllers to trigger the potential physical damage. As I was mentioning, the malware itself had reverse engineered TriStation protocol, which was proprietary. Schneider keeps this very close to their chest. So to actually obtain this, it's likely that the attackers would have obtained a copy of the code or something like that to reverse engineer the protocol and build it out like that. Another interesting fact is that they were identifying controllers that were in a program mode. There is a safety mechanism built into the controllers to prevent loading code into the controllers, which is quite interesting. So the impact of the attack, there were multiple outages associated with Trisys. The plant went down for about a week in August of 2017, and then we also identified there was another outage in June of 2017. Now these outages were about a week to 10 days each. You're talking over $100 million per outage, so it's not like a small thing. And the successfully shutting down the plants, however, it's likely with the level of access they had to these safety systems, this wasn't their intended goal. They didn't want to shut down the plant, they wanted to cause longer term damage. Some of the failures that we observed with Trisys as well, a trial and error approach to execution. It looked more like they were using this environment as a test ground. They'd been in there for several months in the plant environment. They'd been running this code number of times, modifying it, changing it, seeing what they can pull back from the controllers, and then going away, working on it, coming back with a new version, running it again. It's likely that differences between the production environment and the test environment that the attackers had resulted in some differences and nuances that they couldn't oversee during the attack, which again resulted in the failure of the execution. And then the shutdowns that were actually occurring eventually triggered us to investigate, and we caught them before they were able to do any damage, which, again, a bit of a failure. So implications of modifying the ESDs. By injecting this code, you have the ability to modify or reduce the safety effectiveness. You cannot rely on the integrity of these controllers after this at this stage. There's a good chance if the plant goes into an unsafe condition that they may not function properly. After doing this, you could leverage compromised control systems or the process control systems within the plant, or you could just wait for an unsafe condition to occur. But it's a lot easier just to start messing with the plant systems without being able to rely on the safety systems to shut down. This would then maximize the potential damage to the plant by causing physical damage. Again, because we didn't really see what the potential was for what their objective was with the implants, I've got a couple of scenarios that could have occurred. The reason I chose these scenarios specifically was the attackers had access to two specific... 5 minutes. I'm almost finished, so I'll wrap it up, give you a couple minutes back. So they had access to two processes within the plant. One of these processes was the sulfur recovery unit. The second process was the burner management unit. I did a little bit of research into what can occur with inoperable burner management and safety systems, and I came across a couple of incidences. One's actually a report from Western Australia Mines and Petroleum. There was an explosion associated with a hydrogen boiler, hydrogen-fired boiler. And basically they said that at the time of the boiler explosion, the burner management system, which allows safe control of the combustion process, was apparently not operating. This is what the attackers had control of. It's something that could easily have caused a considerable incident. There's also another incident that occurred in ExxonMobil in Singapore where a boiler exploded. Again, this is more from inappropriate operation by the plant operators, but it can still result in significant problems. I think that's just a bit of a recap. So basically, we're beyond theoretical implementation of attacks nowadays. The attackers have the capability, they're working on them, they're trying to hone their skills to actually have a easier ability to continue these kind of attacks in the future. Both of these incidents could have been far worse. There are problems and issues that the attackers experienced, unforeseen to them, lucky for us. It's quite possible that these won't be experienced in the future. Execution of these attacks is difficult. Even with a test lab, they're finding that the nuances of a real-world environment is difficult to overcome. These are lucky problems for us, but again, we can't rely on this happening in the future. None of these attacks failed because I don't think the incident response teams or the SOC did. It's purely because the attackers failed themselves. And I've been talking to a number of organizations recently that says, well, we're not a target. We're not big enough. There's bigger fish to fry, right? Unfortunately, there's a lot of organizations that are running the same infrastructure as the bigger fish. And if they can get access to your environment, even though you're not one of the main targets, you're a great testing ground for making sure their tools work. So defensive recommendations, and just to wrap it up, foster relationships between security and engineering teams, getting this awareness of what your organization looks like, work to understand your processes as well. The better you understand what what your organization is actually doing, if it's power generation, know your weaknesses, know your crown jewels. You can better defend yourself and structure your environment around these instances. And then finally, investigate suspicious incidents from an engineering and cyber aspect. In that Trisys incident, there was two outages I mentioned. The first one wasn't considered from a cyber aspect. It was a missed opportunity where the engineers could have spoken to the security team, kicked off an investigation. Even if it wasn't a cyber incident, they could have given them great experience, great training. And then you know, had the opportunity to prevent that second massive outage. So I don't have time for questions, but I have to wrap it up there. I'll be in the breaks later if anybody wants to talk further. Cool.